Now let us see what happens when a mobile node enters a proxy mobile IPv6 domain. I have copied this image from the RFC 5213. So when a mobile node enters the proxy mobile IPv6 domain, it attaches itself to the access link provided by the mobile access gateway. The mobile access gateway then identifies the mobile node and checks if it is authorized to use the proxy mobile IPv6 service. So if it is authorized, then it will also acquire the mobile node ID, that's the unique ID to identify the mobile node. It could be the MAC address, and this is acquired through a router solicitation message. The router solicitation message is sent by the mobile node to the mobile access gateway. The mobile access gateway, upon receiving the router solicitation message, it sends a proxy binding update to the local mobility anchor. The proxy binding update will contain the details of the mobile node, that's the mobile ID and the MAC details, and that will be required for the binding cache entry. Upon receiving the proxy binding update, LMA will check if the binding cache entry data structure already has the details for this mobile node. If not, it will create an entry in the binding cache entry with a mobile node ID and will create a home network prefix. The proxy binding update has a flag to indicate that it is not a binding update, rather a proxy binding update sent by the MAC, which is for the proxy mobile IPv6. The additional details the proxy binding update contains is the access link technology used by the mobile node, the handoff indicator. The handoff indicator says whether the handoff is between the mobile access gateway, so mobile node moved from one access gateway to the other access gateway, or is it between the interface of the mobile node. So if the mobile node has two interfaces through which it can connect to the mobile access gateway, two different technologies, even that handoff can be indicated in proxy mobile IPv6, that is the proxy binding update. Upon receiving such a proxy binding update, the local mobility anchor will check if it is proxy binding update is according to the proxy mobile IPv6 specification, or if it is not, then the local mobility anchor will reject the proxy binding update. So there will be no registration in the binding cache entry. If the local mobility anchor accepts the proxy binding update, then it will check the binding cache entry data structure if the mobile node is already present. So based on the mobile node ID, it will check if the entry is already present in the data structure. If not, it will create a new entry in the data structure and it will assign a home network prefix for the mobile node. So there is also a flag in the binding cache entry which indicates this is a proxy registration. The link information to the mobile node, that is the mobile access gateway details, so through what address can the mobile node be reached from the local mobility anchor. So in short, after accepting the proxy binding update, LMA will allocate a home network prefix and then it will create a binding cache entry, that is this one, and sets up a tunnel for the a bidirectional tunnel with the mobile access gateway and sends a proxy binding acknowledgement to the mobile access gateway, where this is the care of address of the mobile node. So this is a proxy care of address of the mobile node. The proxy binding acknowledgement will contain the home network prefix which will be used to identify the mobile node in the proxy mobile IPv6 domain. So the home network prefix will be the unique identifier to identify the mobile node in the entire proxy mobile IPv6 domain. So the address of the mobile node is the home network prefix, and it will not change when the mobile node changes from one mobile access gateway to the other access gateway. So these are the steps in proxy mobile IPv6 when the mobile node enters the proxy mobile IPv6 domain. So it's basically receives the router advertisement message with the home network prefix. So until the bidirectional tunnel is set up, the mobile access gateway will not send a router advertisement in response to the router solicitation message. So now if the mobile node moves from this mobile access gateway to the next mobile access gateway, so when the mobile node changes the mobile access gateway, again a router solicitation message is sent to the mobile access gateway. So now it's for the mobile access gateway 2, and the mobile access gateway 2 will send a proxy binding update to the LMA, the same LMA, and the LMA will check the binding cache entry data structure. It finds the mobile node ID, so it will change the details. So the MAG address will change, and the care of proxy care of address will also change. And after that, it will create a new, it will set up a new bidirectional tunnel with the new MAG for this particular mobile node. So the bidirectional tunnel will be with the MAG 2. So the care of address has changed, but the address to identify the mobile node in the proxy mobile IPv6 domain remains the same, that is the home network prefix. When the mobile node leaves one of the MACs, the mobile access gateway, it detects that the mobile node is unreachable. So this mobile node is unreachable for this mobile access gateway. When it detects a mobile node is unreachable, it will send a node deregistration message to the local mobility anchor, and the local mobility anchor will start a timer for that particular mobile node. So especially the timer to decide how long the entry for the mobile node should be there in the binding cache entry data structure. So there can be two possibilities when a node is unreachable. One, it has changed the mobile access gateway within the proxy mobile IPv6 domain, or it is not reachable at all. So if the timer expires, then the binding cache entry for that mobile node is removed from the local mobility anchor. And if the mobile node is registered through a new mobile access gateway, then the binding cache entry remains, but with the new care of address, the proxy care of address, and a new MAG details. So that is how the registration and deregistration of the mobile nodes is done when the mobile node moves from one access router to the other access router, or mobile nodes moves out in IPv6 proxy mobile IPv6 domain. With all these details, the question still remains is, why do we need a bidirectional tunnel, and how does the correspondent node, which was having communication with the mobile node, keep the connection active even after the mobile node has changed the access router? To answer this question, I have copied an image from Wikipedia. So if we look at the image, any packet that the mobile node sends to the correspondent node will be received by the mobile access gateway. And mobile access gateway will send the packets to the local mobility anchor on the other side of the tunnel. So through the bidirectional tunnel, the packets will be sent from mobile access gateway to the local mobility anchor. The local mobility anchor, after receiving the packets, will remove the outer header and send the packets to the destination, that is the corresponding node. And when the packets are coming from the corresponding node, the corresponding node will send the packets to the home address of the mobile node, and not directly to the MAG or the mobile node. Rather, it will send to the home address of the mobile node, which is the local mobility anchor, which will forward the packets to the mobile access gateway through the bidirectional tunnel, and the mobile access gateway will decapsulate the packet intending for the mobile node and send it through the home network prefix. If the mobile node changes the mobile access gateway, so for example if the mobile access gateway 2 is present here and the mobile node moves from here to here, then a new bidirectional tunnel is created and the corresponding node can still send the packets to the same address, and the LMA, that is the local mobility anchor, will handle the handoff that has occurred during that time. So the mobile node is also unaware of the change of the care of address and also the corresponding node. So the corresponding node keeps sending the packets to LMA and LMA will send it to the correct mobile access gateway. So why do we need proxy mobile IPv6, or what are the advantages? So one of them is if the proxy mobile IPv6 is implemented by the service provider, then the mobile node can change the access router. So it can go from one access router to the other access router without changing the IP address, and also without any software or hardware modifications to the protocol stack of the mobile node. So mobile node is completely independent of any changes in the network infrastructure. The other advantage is this protocol allows building a common network to accommodate various access technologies like WiMAX, 3GPP, 3GPP2 or wireless LAN. To show one of the examples, I have taken an image from Cisco website. In this image I can see the proxy mobile IPv6 used in the Wi-Fi network. So basically after the firewall there is a local mobility anchor, which is the home agent for the mobile nodes in the Wi-Fi network. So the Wi-Fi access point is changed, then the mobile node's IP address will not change. So the corresponding node, which is outside the proxy mobile IPv6 domain, will send the packets to the home agent, that is the local mobility anchor. So here we can see the proxy mobile IPv6 protocol and the level 2 protocols and the 802.11. So this is a simple Wi-Fi example of the architecture, how the proxy mobile IPv6 can be used. One of the exceptions is if the corresponding node is within the proxy mobile IPv6 domain, so somewhere below this MAC, then the packets are directly sent to the MACs within the proxy mobile IPv6 to which the mobile node is connected, rather than sending to the local mobility anchor. So that's the only time when the packets are sent directly to the MAC rather than to the LMA. For more details on proxy mobile IPv6, you can refer the request for comments 5213 for the proxy mobile IPv6.